Alexei Novikov, the moderator of the discussion.
Alexei Novikov is given the floor.
Добрый день, уважаемые друзья.
Good afternoon, dear friends, dear colleagues. I would like to thank you for coming here to this session. Allow me, first of all, to tell you a few words about the ideas that we had before this session and why do we think that this one is a key session in the forum. When we thought of how our contemporary megalopolises developed, we thought that, we can't say about modern megalopolis thinking only about the scale. We should also think about time, and we should think that megalopolises are developed in prospects, and we should plan these prospects for 100 years. And any manager, any administrator of the city always has this time vector in his head. And when we're talking about the prospects for 30 and 50 years, we should understand what elements of the contemporary carcass of the megalopolis can play the launch role in the process, in the results that we will see in several years. And in the context of the Moscow, we are talking about polycentricity, about the fact that Moscow has overcome its administrative borders, the construction line, and it is moving forward to the 4D world, to the internet, and it becomes an interesting conglomerate, a dynamic conglomerate that can't develop only around one center. And therefore, we have a question of polycentricity that arises. When we observed the inventory of the projects, we understood that there are certain gifts for Moscow that we will have in 30, 50 years. The first gift is the project on Moscow River. That's the linear center model that unpacks the regions. And we have the polycentric continual structure that goes along the Moscow River. And it creates centrality not only in the center itself, but also allows to achieve this centrality in other suburban regions of Moscow.
Московский кольцевой железной дороги.
And Moscow railroad ring and the carcass development of the third transportation passage. And the third gift is industrial zones in Moscow, old industrial zones that can become the new centers of employment. And another details, the first one is the new Moscow. And it can be either a gift or a risk. But anyhow, if we will develop the standards of regional development, middle class housing, the quality of city environment, then it may become the model of agglomeration of the future, the agglomeration that we will see in 30, 50 years. And here we can either make mistakes or have certain advantages in future. And the last thing are people. And we understand that polycentrism is not only dealing with engineering infrastructure or economic agglomeration. These are humanitarian regions where people feel comfortable. And that, for sure, is the polycentrism of identity. And we will have a discussion around these topics today. And I'm glad to represent our today's speakers. First of all, Mr. Husnulin, Deputy Mayor of Moscow for Urban Development and Construction. Then Yuri Grigoryan, head of the project Meganom Architectural Bureau. Then Andrei Grudin, General Director of the Pioneer Investment Company. Then Lawrence Barth, Professor of Urbanism at the Graduate School of Architectural Association, the member of the Academy of Urbanism. Vincent Guyard, a Chief Architect of Barcelona from 2011-2015, the head of Goyard Architects and the founder of IAAC. Anthony Flanagan, the founder of Balvar Properties, LLC, the United States. And Fadi Jabri, Executive Officer at the Architectural Bureau, Nikken Sekei, Japan. And we've also invited experts that are in the hall. And I would like to introduce them: Andrei Metelsky, Deputy Chairman of the Moscow City Duma; Alexander Loshkin, architect, urbanist, advisor to the mayor of Novosibirsk; Alexei Zoltov, general director of MLRR joint stock company; Leonid Kievsky, professor, chief researcher at the City Development Research and Design Center; Alexander Timohov, deputy chairman of the Committee for Architecture and Urban Planning of Moscow; Marina Lepeshkina, first deputy director of Research Project Institute of General Planning of the City of Moscow; Natalia Tishendorf, CEO of Romanov Property Holdings Fund; Vadim Khrapun, partner at PricewaterhouseCoopers in Russia; and Irina Erbitska, architect in residence at the SKOLKOVO Center for Urban Studies. And I hope that we will have an interesting discussion today. And first of all, we will give the floor to the speakers, and each speaker has 5 minutes. And after that, we will be involved in the discussion with our experts. And now I would like to give the floor to Mr. Marat Khosnolin. Good morning, dear friends, dear colleagues. This year we have some kind of a jubilee of the 5 years of the implementation of construction strategy of Moscow and the fifth International Moscow Urban Forum. Moscow today is the largest dynamic megalopolis, the territory of which has grown 2.5 times and the annual budget has grown by 25%, 300 million. And the mayor has set a plan to make the city comfortable for life, make it comfortable for living and for work. And this was the goal of us for the 5 years. And I would like to share the general overview, what the city does in the polycentric development, what are the specific moments that we pay attention to. 5 years ago, estimating the urban system in the city, the government decided to organize transformation, and the basics for that became the formation of the polycentric development of the city. And the main drivers of development were the comprehensive development of transportation infrastructure in the territory around new transportation objects. And today for Moscow, you know, the major transportation problem is that 380 cars per 1,000 people. So we are the world leaders in this indicator, and that strongly influences the development of the city. The next driver is the joining of new territories, New Moscow Project, where our main goal is the formation of new growth places for the economics of the city development and in order to overcome the problem with migration. 90% of the population lives in the periphery, and 50% of jobs is concentrated in the city center. The next driver is the renovation of municipal areas, and we've talked a lot about that at the previous sessions. That's our stock you see here. You see on this slide what territories of the city are involved under the industrial zones. And the main driver here is the activization of Moscow River, not only as the transportation point. And in order to implement all the events, we've adopted a complex of administrative solutions. And in the beginning of our 5 years work, we've considered over 1,000 previously existed investment projects on the construction of city areas and reoriented it along with the business community to the new principles of urban development. And as a result, we've carried out a transition to comprehensive development of the territory. And we also shifted to the formation of 3-year city budget in order to plan our actions. And now we have an established budget of the city, and it is adopted by our deputies, by our legislation for this year and for 2 future years. And that's 1.5 trillion rubles. And during this period, we plan to construct 8 800 objects, and that's the starter for attracting investment. And talking about investment, I could say that the share of state investment does not make up more than 20%. Is less than 20%. So that's some kind of starter. And as a result, we planned and prepared a new general plan, master plan, that by the middle of 2016 will be adopted along with the master plan. The land use rules will be also adopted. And we shifted all the state services on giving construction permits to the digital area, and you can get any construction permit now over the internet. And we also formed a large-scale program for the development of transportation infrastructure, and its share makes up 70% of our budget. And the development of transport today is the main driver of the development of Moscow. And another factor that I would like to draw your attention to, because I think that that's our achievement, that the mayor of the city is personally involved in the construction policy. And two times a week, we organize meetings on urban development. And I'm not talking about special meetings that the mayor holds weekly. And due to that and our team, we've managed to attain specific results. And I will tell you about that. And as I see it, what risks do we have here? As for the risks, our colleagues will tell us about that. The main point is the program of the development of the city, the program of the development the subway. And we want to increase the scope of the subway. And we've introduced over 35 kilometers of the subway rails and built 18 stations. Now 60 kilometers and 60 stations are in construction, and 70 kilometers of the subway is something that we are planning to do for the next 3 years. And we've started the construction of the third interchange hub that should connect underground or railroads and automobile roads. That's the largest project. So we've grown our subway four times and shifted to such world leaders. China, Beijing, and Shanghai are leaders here. And the next step that we implement along with the Russian railroads is the integration of the Moscow railroad to the internal transportation. And in 2016, we will launch the movement in the small road of the Russian railroads. And 21 hub here will be the major interchange hub. And it goes through the center of the city, through industrial areas, and it will become the major driver for development of the central part of the city. 300 million passengers is something that we expect to transport. And it will decrease the time for the transportation by 20 minutes. And above the ring, we're also working on radial areas of the development of the railroad. And we've already launched the new line for 40 kilometers to Zelenograd. And now the people of Zelenograd, they're also the citizens of Moscow. And it takes them 20, 25 minutes to get to Moscow. And along this ring, we have 11,000 hectares of land, and it will provide an impetus for the future development of the city. Our next step is the intersection hubs project. We plan to build 169 transportation hubs. We have four major operators on these projects, and you see on the map the whole city is in these spots that we are working on the hubs. We started actively working 2 years ago, and now I can say that we have all the limits for development. We have planning regulations, and some part of the projects are already approved and underwent public hearings. And now the Almaty hub is given to the competition, so everyone can be can take part in it. And the territory that is activated along these hubs is the territory with the potential of development. It's 20 million square meters of development. And we've also reviewed our infrastructure. We extend our transportation lines. And you see on this slide the temps, the pace of the introduction of the new roads. And during the recent 10 years, recent 5 years, we had a 10% growth of the city roads, of all the roads that were constructed. 112 artificial installations like bridges and so on. And another important factor, we've built 139 pedestrian passages that makes up 30% of all the existing Moscow underground passages. And due to these events, we increase pedestrian accessibility, the connection between the regions, and make the passages more safe and comfortable. And as for the roads, we've built two times the amount comparing with the previous 5 years. And in the next years, we have a plan. Now we are providing more efforts to the new Moscow. And the access main line, Kaluga main line, will be built there, and it will be connected to the ring. And we also renovate the ring road, nine intersections at the intersection with the ring road, at the interchange of the ring road. And as for the parking lots, I think from the first place in the traffic jams, we moved to the fourth position. And in the Moscow agglomeration, we've added 1 million cars, and that's 20% more cars that we now have. And we hope that this complex of these measures will allow us in future to mitigate this negative trend and improve the situation. The next stage for the development is the comprehensive development of territories. And getting ready to this forum, we've compared us with the largest megalopolis like London and New York. And we've seen the following indicators. The investment to major capital exceed these indicators for London. The capital expenses also are more than in London and New York. So considering the complex economic situation, we increase the investment to the capital in Moscow. And as we've reconsidered all the construction plans for Moscow, for 5 years, we've managed to build 10% of the all property of Moscow. And during the 5 years, we've built 41.5 million square meters, and over the half of that is in the new territories of development. We are building in the industrial sites in the new Moscow. And we have large investments that are attracted to the city. And as for the pace of the introduction of the office property, we are in the leading positions in the world here. And we have a large scale of investment. And regardless of the complexities that we have, the investors remain in Moscow. And as an example, I can tell you is that we've recently opened, together with the mayor, a new business complex, Kunsava Plaza, that has direct investment, foreign investment for $530 million. And that's 220,000 square meters. And during the 5 years, we've built 62 business centers. We have large hotels networks like Marriott, Four Seasons, 7-Eleven, that started working in Moscow. And we have also observed a serious growth in tourism. During the 5 years, Moscow is more actively attracting foreign tourists. 9.3% growth is observed annually. And we think that that's our point of growth, and we will continue this work further. And the thing that we introduce everything of that on the new territories, that also promotes our policy of polycentric development of Moscow. And most important project is the project of the new Moscow. 2.5 years ago, we started working on this project. That's quite ambitious. project CSCUC indicators on its development, and we plan that in this district of Moscow, over 1.5 million people will live here, and over a million of jobs will be created. That's a major investment project with a cost of 7 trillion rubles. And during these 2 years, beginning from scratch, we've built 7 million square meters of property, kindergartens, medical institutions, hospitals. We've created park zones, and we are actively constructing the roads. And this year, the two new stations will be opened on the territory of the new Moscow, and we couldn't even dream about that 2 years ago. And I would also like to note that one of the major indicators is that as for the jobs on the territory of the new Moscow, we had an increase of 80,000 jobs. So these are quite immense indicators, and what we were striving at, not to take the people to the center of the city for their jobs, but to go to periphery. Now the Kyivskaya main line shows that both streams are high. People go to work or to new territory, and we will continue this policy, and we prepare a number of serious growth points. Technopark in Romantsevo, Agro Center at Food City, and we've also launched another project, and Mr. Sabanin was its author, on the territory of SKOLKOVO. We are going to build an international medical center for 500,000 square meters. What is the main advantage of this sister center? Is that the accredited world technologies of treatment, of medications, of the technologies of constructions will be used there according to the West standards, according to international standards. And we can construct all our medical institutions according to the international standards. That's the breakthrough that will lead to a new level of development of Moscow. And immense work is done in the industrial zones. We have nearly 18,000 square meters of industrial zones, and we've worked 39 projects of replanning, and you see here on this map, the blue are the industrial zones, and mainly they are in depressed condition, so they are our points of growth, and the subway will allow us to develop them. And a vivid example of the development of industrial area is the ZIL area, and here we had, first of all, we developed infrastructure and then housing. Now we have a world-level ice rink there, ice arena, that will host the world championship next year. Private investments were used to construct it, $250 million of investments. And we start developing everything else here. The next project, we are going to commission the Technopark station of the subway, and we plan to construct the station of the small ring of the railways. And Moscow River is also the driver for development. We've presented it last year, and Mr. Sabanin said that it will be one of our main growth points, and we plan to build 24 bridges, 12 pedestrian passages, and 12 road passages. And you see also the figures for the embankments. 71 embankment is planned to be constructed. And when you come here, you see all these projects. They're at the different stage of implementation. But however, we've already started the construction of embankments on ZIL, on Krasnopresnenskaya embankment. So we think that that's our growth point. And I would like to draw special attention to the city project, a large city. And for 2015, we've introduced 1.2 million square meters of real estate. And it provides for the building of 18 million square meters of new real estate sector. And the pearl of the development of the Moscow River is Zaryadye Park. You've seen it on the stalls, and I think it will be An example when in the central part of the city, 13 hectares is transferred to the park zone, to the recreation zone, to the extension of the Red Square, because all the foreigners that come to Moscow, they go to the Red Square, and we think that 12-15 million people will go to this park a year. And so it is fully constructed, and it will be finished soon, and we are getting ready to the football championship 2018. We have no problems. Lozhniki is our main sports arena, and it is it has a very good development, and by the beginning of 2017 it will be finished, and according to the price-quality ratio, I think this will be the best in the world. It will be price efficient. We've also constructed Spartak Stadium that is located on the former industrial zone. There's nothing there, but the stadium is already here. That's 200 hectares that will be developed in this zone. And we've also have the roads prepared there. And after that, we have world-level stadiums, CSK, VTB Arena, and 11 football fields that children will be training in future. And Moscow has shown a dynamic development during these 5 years. We've organized urban forum annually, and we've ordered the estimation at international companies, and PricewaterhouseCoopers have prepared the estimation for us this year. And it compares us with 12 largest megalopolises. And on the main indicators, we've compared ourselves to New York and London. And that's what we should aim to. And now we are leaders on the growth of office real estate, of market real estate. We are and only Beijing is a leader here. As for the introduction of the roads, we are third after Berlin and Singapore. That's the result of the transformation that we've started for 5 years. And it's important for us to develop so intensively and not to make any new mistakes in the development. Therefore, we organize this forum, and we hope that our dear experts that take part in this forum will give us advice, will exchange experience with us. And I thank you for coming here to this forum, and I hope for fruitful cooperation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Husnulin. I have only one question to you regarding the Moscow region as it is. You have mentioned the general plan of Moscow, and to what extent is it important to have compliance procedures with the subject of federation, the Moscow region, and the issues of agglomeration compliance? Are there any problems here, and how do you see the future of it? Yes, it's a rightful question. We can't develop Moscow without Moscow region. It's quite understandable that Moscow region is a united one, and it only has administrative borders. That's why we have the special plan to comply decisions between the Moscow city and the region. Of course, we have arguments, we have different visions, but in total, we managed to find compromise and solution, and I hope that we will be able to comply our general plan, and the Moscow region will also try to comply and to coordinate the territorial plans of development, and we will be able to comply them. Thank you very much. 30 years ago, Barcelona started huge, large-scale project of transformation of its territory, and what we see now is the result of the project. And I would like to give the floor Mr. Vincent Goyart, the person who was the participant of the transformation process in Barcelona in the run of the last 5 years, and he will share his experience and tell us about the lessons they've learned, we can learn from the process of establishment of new Barcelona. So, Vincenta, please, the floor is yours.
So, thank you, Alexei, and congratulations for the organization of the forum. Thank you to Manat Kusnulin for the explanation he made about the development of Moscow. just outside, journalists ask me about economical crisis and about development. And what I say is that, in fact, every economy is having always crisis. The economy is always developed by waves. Now in China, they feel that they are in a kind of crisis, and they are going to redefine how they will be developing in the future. But what is fundamental is to have a long-term vision that is shared by the different mayors that will be in around, and also the vision that should be shared by the citizens and the companies. Because what is fundamental for a city to be well developed is to be consistent on the investment. I always say that we don't have all the money in the world today, but we can have a lot of money in the next 25 years. If every day we make the right investment in the always in the same direction, the transformation in any city will be huge. So, in relation to this, in the 90s, for example, in Barcelona, there were only three libraries, and there were only, in fact, there was no a kind of city library or a national library. But the decision that was taken in some moment was that Barcelona should be decentralized. The first statement, in fact, in the 80s, was the idea was, let's transform the center and let's monumentalize the periphery. So at that moment still was this relationship between a center and a periphery. But then the question is not only to define what is a center and the periphery. The fact is to make disappear the periphery. No one wants to live in the periphery, and no one wants to be treated as a peripheral neighborhood. So from that point of view, I think in Moscow you have an incredible capacity. Yesterday we were talking with Deputy Mayor of social integration for new people coming here. You should avoid, and I think you are doing, avoid the Paris effect of having the banlieue to have the periphery and then to have the center. So the idea that the city is a machine to make citizens, to transform people that come to anywhere in the city and then to give or to share the same quality of life, I think is something fundamental. So from that point of view, I think that the idea of the polycentric city or the distributed city is something that needs a lot of investment. The city is not made only with infrastructures, that obviously you need to do it. In Tokyo, they have this huge ring. In Beijing, they have also the ring. In London, more than 90% of the people go with metro to work. But what is fundamental is the life experience of every day, where many people in cities like London, New York, or Barcelona can walk to buy food, can walk to the sports center. So for us, the definition for the standards should be obviously understood, as we saw in the previous presentation, to the overall city, but also should be analyzed at the scale of each citizen, at the scale of how life is in every district, in order to understand that in parallel to create a huge cities, as you have here, you can think about a city organized by different pieces. You know, I had a meeting a month ago with someone from Google. They create Google Labs. Now the companies of information, they are entering in the business of cities. And what he told me was, it's funny, he said, we are trying to define what will be a good urban unit. If we are able to do a good urban unit with the right services, etc., we'll be able to do cities as big as we want by connecting those units. My answer was, this unit is called neighborhood. It was already invented in the past. This is related with the walking distance that one person can have in around a radius of 500 meters. And I think this is what we should develop in the future. A city should not have a rich center and a kind of poor periphery. A city should be a metropolis of neighborhoods. The last question I would like to mention is that every city should be thinking on how the economy of the 21st century will be. we see that the new industrialization will be related with digital fabrication. We'll have driverless cars. We'll have the capacity of growing food in buildings in the city. We will have many capacities, and then what is fundamental for cities like Moscow, let's say Beijing and many others, is when you take a decision, don't think in the present conditions of life, but think about the future conditions. We'll have driverless cars as soon as we imagine, more sooner than we imagine. So we cannot be today building the city that was built in many other cities in the 60s and 70s, but should be thinking on the city for the 21st century. I'm sure that Moscow, that by the way is one of the cities rated with most talented people in the world, want to attract more talent and want to develop their leadership also in this new economy of urban innovation, and then this conjunction between good infrastructures, good design, but also a good vision about how the life that is that to come will be developed, I think that this is fundamental for a success big city. So congratulations for your development.
Thank you, Vicente. I have one question to you. When we've been discussing the issues with you before the session, you've mentioned one specific trait which differs Moscow from other large cities such as New York, London, Paris, and so on and so forth. When we talk about these places, we can name a lot of regions and districts which are well known to people besides the names of the cities themselves. For example, Westminster, Chelsea, Camden in London, it's Soho, Little Italy in New York. And when we talk about Moscow, such districts with a vivid cultural identity are not very well known for people abroad, for instance. So from this point of view, how is this process established in Barcelona? Have you established this identity on purpose, or was it established in a chaotic way? So how did the Barcelonian districts acquire their identity?
In cities, nothing happens by chance. You know, there are some people that are thinking how to make things happen. From my point of view, if I can say to the deputy mayor, Moscow has a problem of branding. So in many cases, also in relation with the, let's say, your history, the people are looking to Moscow as something big and a little bit distant. And what is fundamental, I mean, I'm really admiring many things that I never imagined, how is your center, how are your streets, how you have incredible good architecture. And then from my point of view, you should really try to have a better branding on your city to side, in order to make it more kind of maybe human face, something that also tried to connect, to generate empathy with the people. This is what we try to do in Barcelona, and that's why, for example, we are hosting today the Mobile World Congress and many other congress, because the people want to come to Barcelona in order to have the Barcelona experience, no? So from that point of view, I think that this idea of trying to have a more human face to outside of Moscow, from my point of view, will be a big success. And the other question is how you brand your neighborhoods and your districts. I would like to know at least three or four names of neighborhoods in the city, and I don't know any of them. So from my point of view, in order to understand the city in a more human scale, is fundamental to talk about different places, and obviously not only about the big name of Moscow. This is how we did it in Barcelona. And today is the 10th most visited city in the world, fourth in Europe, first non-capital, first city with crises in the world. So now tourism is even becoming a problem. So let's say that for the future of Moscow, this idea of branding and being a more human face for me will be fundamental.
Thank you very much, Vicente. And the river in any city is a huge gift to the city, and we know a few examples at the moment when the river became a very successful urban establishing access. We have very successful examples when the river became a park, the example of Harney level, and we have the examples from Valencia, but these are quite few projects, and we can enumerate all of them. The Moscow has proposed the project of the development of the Moscow River and adjacent territories, and it seems to me that this project will be not only unique for Moscow, but for the whole world. And I would like to give the floor to Mr. Yuri Grigoryan, the author of the project, the head of the organization which has won the competition to develop the project, and to ask Yuri how this project was conceived, what was the ideology, and what role is it to play in the concept of the polycentricity of Moscow and Moscow agglomeration.
Раз. Спасибо большое за приглашение выступить.
Dear friends, thank you very much for inviting me to talk here, to talk about this project. And it should be noted that the project of the Moscow River has an interesting origin from the consultation session on Moscow that took place 3 years ago in the city. And it became clear then what problems should we work upon. And after that, a contest was organized that we've managed to win. And now I will tell you in a few words about the ideology of this project and how do we plan to integrate it, how it will become the future gift for the citizens. It is called Future Ports, and it is based on the following aims. We simplified them for three main parts: active river, turning the city to the river, face-to-face accessible river, and that now you should coordinate the transportation scheme in order to, first of all, come to river, go along the river, and the most important thing that we've worked upon with the Gen Plan is to push away the transit transport from the embankment to make them pedestrian and clean river. That was the main point for us that we were aiming at. We think that it should be clean, and everyone should pull efforts for that, because that will be something good that we will leave to our children. We've developed several principles, and you see them. You can see them at the exhibition. And you can look at them. And in order to do that, we have had a detailed technology, for example, mixing construction, pushing away these main lines, the construction of parking lots, and two other strategies, the activizing of periphery and making the center green, because the center requires some kind of humanization from our point of view. And these future ports are located at the periphery mainly. And currently we have 40 future ports. Zaredye is one of them, Zil is one of them, City is also one of them. These are the city ports and smaller ports that may in future be competitive. And this will be a natural process. This public port is, roughly speaking, when we prepared for the contest, San Marco Piazza was an example. That was the place where you can come and stay near the river, the place connected to the embankment, and here accessibility and functions are important. That's the public space concentrated on the river that takes us to this river. For example, that's our draft for printing. And when we developed this project with the general plan, Gen Plan was working on the integration in the master plan. We worked on the scale of the port, and this medium scale, it has Zil here, the strategy for the development that is now implemented. And now we have seven major top priority areas, the fragments where the investors' interests coincide with the interests of the city. For example, the Mnevniki lot. So those are the major large-scale projects, most important ones, the territories that will be developed. And as an example, the Zil Peninsula, where both territories are developed. So this new port of a city importance. And we've also dwelt upon the issue of how it should be organized, how this project will be implemented. And I think that Mr. Hosnulin knows how it will be implemented, and we understand it as well. That's some kind of organization that now emerges, the organization of the Moscow River that organizes everything. And this is our picture from the contest when we wanted to make it so that you could go fishing. That's what we are aiming at today, the Red Bank, the lower embankment in the center of the city with a view of Kremlin, and it may become one of the city interesting spots, I think. Thank you. Thank you very much, Yuri. I have one question for you regarding the role of Moscow River as a linear center, a center that will reload residence areas, considering the need to attend central places for the citizens. Central places, I mean the recreations, the job centers, employment centers. What's the logic here? Well, it should be noted that we have a unique potential here when we consider the number of territories that could be reorganized during the project. It turned out that considering as micro-districts were turned inside and river was a periphery for them, and the centers were inside and the river was considered as, well, the green natural periphery. Nowadays, no one plans to build something granite there or to deteriorate this natural environment. We wanted just to turn these regions to the river face to face. Therefore, we organized the establishment of embankments, and this will make the river a linear center. And maybe that's the key large element in Moscow, and we cannot ignore its existence. And I think that in 100 years, when it starts working, everything will be a lot of things will be done today, and it's necessary to do them. But it seems to us that this will become one of the linear or non-linear center of the new master plan. Thank you very much. I have one question to Mr. Hosnulin. In this regard, it's clear that linear object as Moscow River in the urban development sense is a pearl, and to make mistakes, we can't make mistakes in the development. What will be the structure of the monitoring and management of this project? Well, we've agreed the following way. All the territories Moscow River is divided into lots. We have lots that are fully under the city guidance, city monitoring. That's what the city will do, the design, the construction, the embankments, the roads. So that's the this part. We've developed architectural standards for the improvement of the embankments. Somewhere it will be the capital construction, or maybe just improved, and somewhere it will be just natural environment with a quality access zone. These improvement standards were given to all the investors whose projects are connected with the Moscow River. And now we have a large percent of embankments that have no access. So these are former industrial zones. They don't have any embankment at all. And we've agreed with our investors that will work according to our standards, and all the issues on are considered at the mayor's office, and all the technical issues connected with the design. We've defined one of our enterprise as a customer for this work, and they will carry out coordination work of investors, of organizers, and so we will discuss these issues of the on the architectural council together with the developers, together with the designers. So that's the multi-layer scheme of management, and we hope that it will work successfully. Thank you very much. One of the drivers for Moscow is one of the models is Moscow for Moscow is London. London resembles Moscow or does not resemble. It is a unique British city that dominates in the whole system. It was connected from small cities, and it is polycentric in its essence. It resembles Moscow because it is the largest business center, and the organization of business activity in the space exceeds the borders of the city, and new business districts emerge. It has a lot of interests involved, a lot of stakeholders, and you have to agree, and the city administration has to agree with all of them, and they have to agree between with each other. And I would like to ask Lawrence Barr to tell us about the experience of London and about his view on Moscow and about the attempts and plans of Moscow to become a polycentric city.
Thank you very much. I have to begin with a certain apology, and that is, first of all, I was asked to speak about London, but I think in order to understand London, we have to start with two things. One is that I don't believe that London is a polycentric city. I think it is very much a monocentric city, and I'd like to talk about that a little bit. And secondly, I think that we struggle to learn positive things about how it would become polycentric on the basis of London's governance models. And so I want to show, indeed, why we might look to other examples to help us understand these points. Now, along the way, I'd like to pick up on a conversation that Deputy Mayor Kusmunen and I were having last night, which is that the kinds of numbers that the Deputy Mayor has at his disposal are the real proof and foundations of a kind of first step towards good governance. And they become the foundations of what we might think of as qualities, qualities of cities that we're after. The numbers in themselves are not what people are after. The numbers, the amounts that are built are an indication that we're heading in the right direction in terms of aligning trust, confidence in government with the potential to build. But at the same time, we have to move forward to understand what polycentric cities are really about. And they're about creating a diversity of opportunities for residents, for businesses. They're about creating hierarchies and balance in your transportation system so that, in a way, you gain the maximum from your investment. These things are fundamental criteria. So in talking about the polycentric city model, I want to talk about, first of all, the foundations of that as a metropolitan infrastructure. Secondly, the idea that the river can be an instrument of transformation. But most importantly, that there are integrated projects. Now, integrated projects are projects that are at least 150 hectares. So to pick up on Vicente's point, integrated projects are like three neighborhoods where you can see not only the differentiation of neighborhoods, but the possibility of something that will really influence the DNA of the city. Now, you all know this sort of picture of the center of London, where you get that distinctive characteristic of a city that is built along the river. And the upper image there is the new Crossrail system. And I want you to notice that the Crossrail system that will vastly improve London's metropolitan infrastructure for transport is paralleling the river. And it is because it is creating the opportunity for a very stretched, but nevertheless still centralized city. Now, where we really want to go is what is toward a city that really begins to create something much more like a network rather than a ring and radial system. You can never get away from a monocentric city on the basis of a ring and radial system. Now, just to bring out this point, I want to talk about Rive Gauche in Paris. And the eastern side of the city, a tremendous project was developed to span across the Seine to link Bercy to the 13th arrondissement by a very important project that would bring together housing in great diversity, fantastic juxtaposition of housing and office space, tied together with the university, across the bridge across the river links the National Library and housing to a new area where in Bercy they have refurbished former wine warehouses into a lovely little environment. Housing nearby serves all different income groups and population types, a wonderful park with a gallery in the center of the park. This is an indication of something where, in a way, there's been an attitude towards polycentricity that is that finds a home in an integrated project. It's a large project. It can influence the future of the city. Similarly, in Hafen City in Hamburg, we see the expansion of the center of the city, another counterpart to the polycentric city. The center of the city, its qualities have to expand. You'll notice a very integrated, coherent plan based on a consistent morphology, which nevertheless produces a highly differentiated pattern of inhabitation, offices, new residences, and different kinds of qualities of housing that can create a very successful environment even in the early stages of the development process. By contrast, when we look at London, as we move further, and here we're looking eastward and you can see Docklands, and then the big challenge is, as we move beyond Docklands, what do we develop along the Thames? That's our big challenge. And we see, if you kind of look out past, as some of you may recognize where City Airport is, and if you look on towards Barking Reach, then we see projects that look kind of like this. Now this is a very good architectural practice, Shepherd Robson, which is nevertheless in a way in a compromised position of simply having to work for a project that is developer driven and is very, very simple housing. Now it's not necessarily the wrong thing, but it's not the project that is going to create polycentricity. Even again with Shepherd Robson's, again, very beautiful project for a new housing area in the Olympic Park District, you can see that it does not have the level of aspiration or ambition of what is being sought in Rive Gauche and in Hafen City. I'm having trouble, there we go. As we move closer back into the Millennium Village area just across from Docklands, we see the intensity goes up, but not the level of mix and diversity that one is looking for in a true polycentric city. So one of the things then that I think that we are trying to do is to understand if there is a polycentric city model, there are four key points that I think we want to understand about how a series of issues relate together. You want to link development to a balanced transport network. That is, you want to be able to have people getting off the trains and on the trains in relatively equal numbers morning and night, not a flood of traffic into the center of the city in the morning and a mass exodus at the end of the day. You want to sustain vision through civic partnership. That is, you want to get multiple actors involved. So that third point, multiply the stakeholders, is something they've done in both Hafen City and Rive Gauche. And finally, you want to integrate the design reasoning, not just with immediate real estate value, but with long-term values where you gain complexity and value over time. And this is a different attitude about how you use design to deliver integrated projects. With these four points, I would like to say that one of the questions that was put to me was, does London do a good job, or is there a good way in which London can sustain the control over the vision? And the answer, I think, will come to perhaps in more discussion, but the answer to that is we do not have any mechanism for people to take clear responsibility for delivering vision over time. Thank you.
Спасибо большое.
Thank you very much. I have one question regarding interaction I have a question regarding interaction of municipalities and local authorities, political authorities, in terms of this landscape of polycentricity. It's evident that there are a lot of contradictions between them and the city on the other hand. To what extent the tools of cooperation between local institutions, administrative, political, and so on and so forth, enable to solve the issue, and to what extent are they establishing obstacles in this regard?
Thank you very much. Sorry, that was a bit loud. What the new powers of the mayor enable the London mayor to do is to establish strategic opportunity areas. The London mayor can also begin to control better than ever before the transportation infrastructure, can also begin to set economic strategy. However, this is against a backdrop in which the UK has had very centralized control over budgets and strategic decision-making. One of our big discussions is, will we be able to devolve power and budgetary competence to the municipalities effectively? In London, this is compromised even further because planning capacity has largely been held in the 33 small boroughs that make up the City of London. Mm-hmm. So the central authority, while it has strategic competence, does not have final control over planning. Now, this means that the central city, under the direction of the mayor, can initiate ideas through declaring opportunity areas, but there's no real capacity for clarifying fundamental ambitions and vision. And for that reason, all of our projects are developer-driven. Now, where this works particularly well is in areas that have where there's a very clear understanding of what the vocation of a part of the city has to be. So in the area of King's Cross in the center of London, we can see that the developers, Argent, have done a brilliant job. As we move further out and the vision is less clear and there's no overall authority that can establish that vision, what the developers are trying to do is often less clear even to themselves.
Thank you very much. It's evident that the phenomenon of polycentricity is having a lot of layers and constituencies, the condition of environment, of cultural identity, of engineering infrastructure, but also it's possible due to the transport infrastructure, a multimodal transport infrastructure which allows people in different places and areas to have normal public spaces and jobs to come there and backwards. And Japan, in this regard, has made a colossal breakthrough, and it's leading a lot among world countries in terms of organization, transport organization, densely populated cities. You know that Japan has a lot of transport interchange hubs. It has a lot of multipolar hubs. I would like to ask Fadi Jabri to comment on this. So please, Fadi, the floor is yours. Thank you very much. It's a great honor to take the floor in this hall. Here you see the photo of one of the centers of Shibuya.
And
3.5 million people live there, and pay attention to the road that is in the center. It's quite calm. And we see that the transportation problem is solved through public transportation development and through polycentricity. And and in the left you see one of the sub-centers, Shinjuku, and in the right, Roppongi Center, and Shibuya, right in front of us. And if you look at the outer space print, you see the bright center of the Moscow, and the spot of development. And if we look at Tokyo, we see that the emperor's palace is in the center, and it is dark, and large cities are around it. And there are seven sub-centers, quite powerful, and they are in the competition with each other. Each center has its own characteristic. And if the historic center is a business center, we see recreational centers, or centers of local importance. And it should be noted that that's the policy of the city. The city decides where and how to develop the center. And if we consider Shinjuku, where 3 million people live, you see two high towers, the municipality of Tokyo. We also see the college building, the housing is there also, and we see office buildings as well. But such centers are developed for a long time, and you see 50 years here. And we see such sub-centers here. And if we talk about the creation of the neighborhood, and after that we consider the picture of London, and then we see the river. So here we see the powerful sub-centers connected to each other, and they are located 5-10 kilometers away from the center of the city. And they have a good transportation structure, and they are developed through state and private partnership. So pay attention to this map, and it tells us about the value of land there. These centers are competitive to each other, as I mentioned, and we see that the prices in these regions or sub-centers are also growing. And you see this red color. If we compare it to the center of the city, we see that the prices are just the same there. And when we're talking about Moscow, we see that Moscow and Tokyo has a lot of things in common. For example, the space, the population, you see the figures. Two cities have developed subway, but Moscow lags behind in the number of stations. So the development of this intersection hubs is quite pressing for Moscow. And it would be wonderful for us to attach this topic to the development of sub-centers. And these sub-centers are mostly located near the railway lines that allow for the future development of these adjacent territories. And if we look at the structure of Moscow, we have such centers where one can have such powerful sub-centers. For example, Komsomolskaya district, they have a daily stream of people, and it gives the good potential for creation of sub-center. And here we can unite three railway stations and connect them to the subway stations and place business units there that are now scattered across the center of the city. And the small ring road of the railways allows us to join these sub-centers that will create comfort for the city. And in conclusion, I'd like to say that the development of these sub-centers that we've seen now, they are quite large scale and over 150 hectares are developed. But we should have a strict structural plan of the city. And it should be a long-term plan for several decades, I would say. And in order to develop such centers, we should change the codes. And here there's a special moment in Moscow, for example, the regulations on schools, on the height of the schools. So we should consider this kind of legislation. And we should also create favorable conditions for structures here. Here we have this principle where we should favor the developer who builds the things that the city wants, and he gets less taxes, for example, and more attractive financing. And all in all, the city is a life structure. The centers are in competition with each other, and it's very important to have this competition. And the information should be updated all the time about the centers in order to promote their future development. Thank you. Thank you very much. I have a question. Well, Moscow is one of the densely populated cities, second after Dhaka, if we don't consider the borders of the new Moscow. On the other hand, it's one of such cities that has a lot of parks or unconstructed areas. And one of the problems for transportation here is found in this point, because people sometimes choose cars in order to overcome the distances, in order to get some consumer goods. And one of the ways out of the situation is making the city dense with commercial, with trade activities, in order to make this these places in pedestrian accessibility. And such centers are generated by this densification of the structure. Do you agree with this question? And what's your view on making the Moscow denser with commercial activity as an instrument in order to solve transportation problem? Well, I fully agree with you. And we've shown a number of points where you can create these dense centers for future development. But I see that here there's one point, the provision for the neighborhoods with consumer goods. And another point is that the city itself should create these powerful centers for future development. What I've shown today laid more emphasis on these powerful subcenters, on these new structures. I don't know whether it suits Moscow or not, but that's the experience of Tokyo that I wanted to show you. Thank you very much. I have yet another question to Mr. Husnulin about the words of our speaker about the need for new construction regulations in these transportation intersection hubs. Is this problem pressing, and how is city planning to solve it? Well, yes, it is a pressing problem. It is a pressing problem now, and we're trying to solve it through special technical conditions. And at the federal level, we were given the authority to actively work with the Ministry for Construction, and we want to take the norms and regulations in design from Japan, because we think that they've done a lot in this direction. And we're discussing this issue with our Hong Kong colleagues and Singapore colleagues. So all the regulations that we need in order to design, we will establish them by our legislative acts, because the problem is really acute now. And according to our regulations, we can't carry out construction, contemporary construction. Therefore, there is a need to review them. Thank you very much. One of the opportunities for Moscow for the development of polycentricity is for sure the zones of redevelopment, and there are quite a lot of them. That's true, but we could not commission to full extent the redevelopment, and therefore the experience of other cities is interesting for us. And I would like to ask to tell us about this experience. I would like to ask Mr. Flanagan about that.
Good morning, everybody. I first of all want to say that I'm absolutely thrilled to be here in Moscow. I haven't been here for quite a few years, and I've heard over the last few days that there have been tremendous changes in the last 5 years. I look forward to seeing those. I think my perspective is a little different than some of the panel. So much of the discussion today has been kind of large grain discussion. My focus is more on the fine grain of the city. And secondly is, my perspective is that of a developer. I'm a developer and an investor, and I'm not an architect, I'm not a government official, I'm not a planner. So in that way, we look at the world a little differently. I think we see ourselves really as makers, makers of places. And so what I wanted to do today is talk about a few things. First of all, we've seen over the last 10 or 15 years, we've seen change, some significant change in kind of social patterns. And a lot of that has to do with technology and people's relationships to that and how it's changed people's interest in their communities. So with that, let me just show you a few things. First of all, I have received a lot of inspiration from Jane Jacobs, who constantly reminds me that the cities, first and foremost, are for people. And I think it's important for us to never forget that. And that when we do our work, we are always looking at the level of the individual. What makes a place successful for the individual or in social gatherings. So there's some patterns that we've noticed over the last 10 or 15 years. First of all, one that's important for us never to forget, and that is that people haven't changed. In some ways, they haven't changed. We're social human beings. And when we think of the work that we do, we are constantly reminding ourselves of not only what changes have occurred in the world, but those things that are constant. And much of our work is very international. Our practice is in China, we're in San Francisco, we're in a number of places. And that's helpful for us because we're always dealing with cultural differences and business practice differences. But at the base level, in our cities, people want the same thing. The same thing in Moscow as they want in San Francisco or Washington, D.C. or Shanghai or Moscow. So we're constantly reminded by that. And then there's technology, and technology has changed a lot of our patterns from day to day. The first thing I think is important for us to remember in our work, much of the work that we do is around developing retail, street retail and commercial centers, is that first and foremost, an individual doesn't have to come to your store, doesn't have to shop on the street anymore. You can shop in your living room. You can shop at 12 o'clock in the afternoon, or you can shop in your pajamas in the middle of the night. So that's very important to understand, because what we see is that what that has done is it's changed the reason why people go places. They no longer have to go to the mall to shop. They don't have to do those same things that they used to do because you can do that at your home. So that's made kind of a profound impact on the work that we do, and I think that what you see is it is making a change. I actually think it's a positive change in the community. So let me just show you a few examples. I only have a few minutes, and I do have an opportunity to speak tomorrow at greater length. So today is, I'll just briefly show you a few examples of some of the work that we've done, and then some of the work that my colleagues have done in various places. So three projects I want to just very briefly talk about, Shenzhen D in Shanghai. The other one is Treasure Island in San Francisco, and a project that we developed about 15 years ago was Santana Row District in the Silicon Valley area. Shenzhen Z was done by a colleague of mine in Shanghai, pretty much in the center of the city. And the core of the project, although it's it says here on the screen that it's 1.2 million square meters, the core of that project, what really makes that project work, is a very small area of less than about 100,000 square meters. And it's really the heart and soul of that project. And that's the area known as Shentanzi. It's a beautiful area in downtown Shanghai. And it's very much focused on street activities. It's a place where people want to meet. It's kind of Shanghai's living room, in a way. A place where you go in between work and home. And it's become very, very popular as a place. And it's always crowded with people. And it's created huge value for the rest of the development in the area. In fact, I would say that Shentanzi today probably is one of the most successful development areas in Shanghai. And much of that is as a result of one small core to the project, which creates kind of this outdoor living room. A few more pictures of the area. And then as you can see all around it, there's a major commercial development that was part of that district. Then several years ago, I was involved in Treasure Island. It's Treasure Island is an island just off in the bay, very, very close to downtown San Francisco. And this was a wonderful opportunity to create another one of the last new neighborhoods for the city of San Francisco. As most of you may know, San Francisco is a peninsula. It's 49 square miles. So its opportunity for growth is extremely limited. And one of the last remaining large pieces of property is the Treasure Island property. And so what we did was we looked at that project utilizing many of the kind of guiding principles that we've learned over the years about creating neighborhood. And first and foremost, we come from a perspective that says that some of the best cities in the world are those cities that start first and foremost with great neighborhoods. And so we really focused on that, trying to understand the relationship of the San Franciscan citizen and place. What are those things that they want? Walkable communities are important. Compact, dense are important. Creating kind of some kind of regional draw was important. So those are the things that we placed a lot of focus on. The last property I want to show you is Santana Row. This was actually the first project that we did that was mixed use, vertically integrated. It's approximately 18 blocks. It's a very small property. It's less than, it's about 100,000 square meters, 150,000 square meters, I believe. This project is mixed use. It receives about 13 million people per year that want to come here, that want to come here and spend time here. And so this was our first project, actually, that we did in this kind of configuration. And it's our understanding it's one of the first projects like this in North America. It's been hugely successful. And my colleague in Shanghai actually used Santana Row as their model for creating Shentanzi. So we're very pleased with that. So for us, the challenge is in creating these projects is the how to create the projects, keeping in mind, again, that we see ourselves as makers. We have kind of a commitment for profitability, but we also take very seriously the fact that what we build remains in the community and must serve as a benefit for the community for many, many years, well beyond our lives. So, and we take that very seriously. So for us, the challenge is to think about how you can create these kind of environments in various communities in different cultural settings. And what we've done is we've defined kind of 12 elements that you can see on the screen that we think all of these projects share. And in fact, when you go to places like Barcelona and so many other places around the world, we see these elements as the kind of core elements in those places that make them successful. Issues like story, creating story. It's a physical sense of story and also a personal sense of story, which I will talk about tomorrow at greater length. Synergy is very, very important. These are mixed-use developments, and mixed-use is important because it creates a certain kind of dynamic quality. It creates kind of a 24/7 lifestyle. Whereas before, in the 1960s and the 1970s, we were all very used to separating in a planning perspective. Office is in one location, retail is in another location, residential is in another location. And what that creates is kind of dark places at different times of the day. After 5, the office district is closed. After 8, the residential district is closed. And so what we've done is we've brought these things together, which has created a completely different dynamic in which the place is alive 24 hours a day because of that. We think that's an incredibly important part of successful development. So there are a long list here, which we have no time to really talk about today, and hopefully we can talk about it maybe after the presentation. But I'd like to invite you to think about the concept of making and what are the key and core elements that make these places successful. This is something that we think is incredibly important for the future of our cities. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We're short of time, but I'd like to ask you one brief question. You were talking.
Trade versus mall. Well, what would be the best start for polycentric model in our city, in Moscow?
Street versus mall.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, that's a really important question. We're virile advocates of the street. However, we've also been involved in incorporating both street and mall together, and is necessary because in some environments you want to have some indoor environments, and so how do you merge those? But I really do think that the kind of the life of the city is the street. It's the space between the buildings. So much can happen there for public life that is so positive. And I think it's important for us to not think of our streets as rivers, rivers for cars or rivers for people, but they in fact are places. So creating an environment where people want to be, where they want to stay, where they want to meet, they want to imagine the future, that's the kind of street environment that that we really try to envision and create.
Thank you very much. Спасибо большое.
Thank you very much. The point is that one of the key issues of polycentricity in the city is the issue of occupation centers, and occupation centers need relevant infrastructure and construction and site development. But first and foremost, it's the most complicated part from the point of view of communication construction and design, and it's very complicated. And moreover, if it passes through the economic cycle, we have times when we have abundance of office premises, sometimes we lack them. But nevertheless, the economy of the sector needs to work. That Moscow has new occupation centers and corresponding construction and buildings. In this regard, I would like to ask to comment on this situation, Andrei Grudin. Andrei, please.
Спасибо, Алексей.
Thank you very much, Alexei. I will try to be short, although we can talk for a long time on this topic. I would define three major points that are quite important for business and to make business invest, to make the city developed in a polycentric direction. First of all, it seems to us that the city should have a long-term strategic plan, so the city acts as a large corporation. It can't live without strategy. And the strategy should define the goals, the principles according to which the development will go. Will it be high-tech development or touristic development, industrial development, and so on? Such things should be clear for investors, for the business community, because it creates the idea for us, the field for pulling efforts. That's the first point. The second point, it is important for the city to continue the development of transportation carcass, because how comfortable it will be to get from one point to another point, well, that's the key driver for polycentricity. And we've carried out a research, considered not only Moscow, and we understood that business activity is growing 50% in the places where there are subway stations. Rent grows, real estate prices grow, and Moscow recently has done a lot in this direction, and we feel it. The third important point is somehow an unpopular measure, but without it, we can't do without it. We should have a more differentiation and a stricter regulation of taxation and administration. Moscow has a cadastre value, and we know that in the center of the city it's higher, and it can be two or three times more if we compare it to the regions, average regions of Moscow. But there is also an administration issue, and I will give you an example. Our headquarters is located at Krasnaya Presnya, in one of the costly regions. Back offices are in other regions of Moscow, and our windows face Rasvet, a motor vehicle plant. It doesn't hasn't been working for a long time, and the territory it has some rusty cars and so on. And there's a question: how can this land be so costly, and how can it be filled with such places? What's wrong here? Maybe the owners can afford to keep such a plant in this area. So I would like to draw your attention to the administration of such regions. And I think that we should stimulate business to construct in other centers far away from the historic center of the city, and we should give some tax benefits there and other supporting incentives. But at the same time, we should stimulate, or rather push away by economic means, inefficient enterprises from the centers, inefficient lenders, inefficient owners, and this will create a natural evolutionary shift to periphery, because business won't be able to work without profitability. There's no means to build empty offices, empty business centers somewhere in the periphery. So that's how I see it. That's an important point that I would like to draw your attention to. So these are the three major points that I'd like to dwell. We can't do it without long-term strategy. We should continue the development of transportation infrastructure, and we should have an in-depth differentiation of taxes. Thank you. Thank you very much, Andrei. I have a question, the following one. Moscow plans to introduce land use regulations, and for you as a developer, will it be a guarantee of getting a stable legal basis for functioning? Thank you for your question. Well, really, for us, it will be a bit more stable and business-like stability because it can't act in the long term without some kind of defined strategies. So that's a positive step forward for the future. Thank you very much. We have just a few minutes, but I would like to give the floor to the experts. And as we've started talking about development, I have a question to Natalia Tischendorf. How do you think, how can city help to create comfortable urban environment for business? So please give the microphone. Just a moment. Good afternoon. During the recent 5 years, the city has changed. We've seen a lot of constructions, new public places, business centers. And as a Muscovite, I can see that the city has become more beautiful. And I was going here, and I liked the natural urbanism project. And I share these trends that we see Moscow government is implementing. And for sure, Moscow government has strong demands to the architecture of this new project. But all in all, this is a new project. And we, as Muscovites, want to live in a new environment. And developers and investors should also share these rules, I think. And we've considered statistics that each Muscovite spends more than 60 minutes to get from home to work. And it seems to me that all these incentives that the Moscow government is implementing now will at least reduce this time to times and will lead to the fact that the citizens will get some additional time for their families, for their health, for their hobbies. And the major question that you asked me, how to attract investors to the implementing of important projects, well, I think that this project will be in demand among the population, as Andrei said. I think that the investors won't be motivated. We don't need to motivate them. So give information, inform the investors, show the prospects, and give a chance to implement the project. Because development is a long-term project. So please show them the prospects for development of the city. And I think give the opportunity to the professional to make his work. And the question to Andrei Metelsky. We were talking about polycentricity, about creating the identity of people. And you as a person working in Moscow State Duma and as a person connected to the work with people, how do you see whether we have our Chelsea, our Soho, our small Italy or not? I don't know. Well, first of all, thank you for your question. I can say that Moscow is developing quite seriously. And I can see that this polycentric model is characteristic for all major cities, and Moscow is not an exclusion. And here I'd like to note that, as for me, it's obvious that Moscow will have its own development centers, will have its own specific urban forms that will attract population. But I would like to note another thing. There was an idea, don't interest investors. Well, we should interest the investors, and we should always offer conditions for them to attract, to develop the situation. If we develop polycentric models, we should attract investors from the center to the regions or to other development regions of the city, because if we won't attract them, won't give them some preferences, then they will have no will to work and to construct. So we can't interest them with a beautiful dream of the future. We had such a situation 20 years ago. And the second point is that any polycentric model provides for a situation when the city is turning face to face to the citizens. And it's wonderful that now we can see such a situation in Moscow. And I think that's our platform for future success. If we develop this model, then it will give the opportunity to remote regions' citizens not to go to the center, but to remain at their places and to use the services that the city creates, that the investors create, in order to allow them to live comfortably in their own region, in their own district. And not to have any difficulties there. That's the most important point here. Thank you. Thank you very much. I would like to ask the question to Mr. Hripun of PricewaterhouseCoopers. You've organized the research on in the comparison of the Moscow with other cities. And from the point of view of polycentricity, how do you think, what's the potential of Moscow, or what is its rank, what should be done here? And just a few words, though the question is a complicated one. Thank you very much. In the research that we organized, we considered polycentrism as itself, and the potential is quite high. What do we measure is the activity, and for polycentrism, it is growing. Thank you. Irina Rybitska, so please tell us, what do you think about this? So you work at the intersection of architecture and culture, social identity. What's from your point of view is basic here? Thank you for your question. Well, regardless of the of my activity that you noted, now in the center of the SKOLKOVO school, we've organized a mega research on the model of transport-oriented development. And I can say that comparing the undeveloped to full extent the models of transit-oriented development, there are two principal gaps. The first gap is the number of actors of the process. For example, in Moscow, there are two of them. The first point, the construction complex, and it's mainly focused on the construction of housing. And the second point is the business and trade centers that are focused on large shopping trade centers. And that's an outdated model. Old-fashioned model of transit development, and the world has accumulated result of this model already, the mistakes or some other mistakes, and now we are shifting to the development of not one model, transit-oriented development, but to the differentiated line of models of transit-oriented development for large cities, and it turned out so that it will work with small and medium cities, so that's quite a load of work, and I can tell for sure that there is no pure transit-oriented development model in the world. There's no such model in the Russian reality, and we can't have it as an efficient model. So we will have a specific Russian models that take into account the mistakes and that provides focus for future mistakes that may arise at certain stages of the development of this transit-oriented development. And I would also like to note that we can't talk about taking the way of Singapore or some other city Well, they have successful experience, and that's important. But we observe success, and I would like to underline it, at a certain stage of metabolism of the models we have. And so I think that we should stay away from the mistakes that are already made. And the operators of the development of such key stories of transitory interdevelopment is only the can only be the beneficiary of the process that gets its benefits from long-term planning and from the consolidation of city resources. Thank you. Thank you very much, Alexander. I would like to have 1 minute. I would like to comment. Well, we are talking little about what we do at transportation intersection hubs. We have 169 hubs, and each of them is individual. And we are working on them individually. We have interchange hubs that provide only for transportation infrastructure. We have such that provide for trade or housing, for example. So each hub is individual. That's the first point. The second point, when I was giving my report, I told you that the model of city development is aimed at transport interchange hubs. And we consider transport, consider them from the point of view of the development of megalopolis in the next 20 years. So the offers that we are making now, they may seem strange or maybe unrealistic, but they are aimed at the near 20 years. So we are ready to discuss, have a discussion on this topic and tell a bit more details on that. Thank you very much, Mr. Hosnulin. I would like to ask Mr. Loshkin to comment shortly of what he heard from the position of a person who lives in other city from Novosibirsk.
Well, the problem of decentralization is the polycentricity problem. It's characteristic of the most large Russian cities. And when we are talking about polycentricity, we come back to the historic model of the development of our cities, because during the times of the Russian Empire and the Soviet times, they had the monocentric principle of development, but still they had some polycentric traits. But in the run of 25 years, we have lost this polycentricity the cities used to have earlier. I don't know the indicators of Novosibirsk, but I know data about Perm. In the Soviet times, 80% of people were living in the districts they lived in, but now 80% of people work in the center. And when we talk about transport problems, we see that in the run of the last 10-12 years, the number of cars has increased by 25%, and the number of transportation, passenger transportation, increased by 2.5%. And the difference is drastic. But I would like to draw your attention to the fact that only allocation of everyday places or jobs closer to residential areas will not solve the problem as it is, because to solve the issue, there is a need to reconsider our housing policy. And first and foremost, we need to reconsider the principles of allocation of the so-called accessible housing. But because have a look what's happening today. Yes, we create jobs on the periphery, but a person chooses this price-efficient housing not because of the distance from home to work, but from the economic reasons. He buys the cheapest housing he can afford, and it can be far away from its job, his job. And job is also chosen due to economic reasons. And so it happens that instead of increasing the number of transportations, we, instead of decreasing them, we increase them. And that's the world experience of affordable housing. It needs to be not only on the periphery. All the regions need to have affordable housing. And the second point is to develop rent housing to make it competitive and attractive, because rent housing allows a man to choose to alter his residence place very easily. Yes, flexibility, which enables us, which is provided by rent housing for us, is very important. And I would like to ask to comment on transport flexibility by Mr. Zotov, General Director of Genstock Company of the Moscow Small Railway Ring. We've been talking about that transport is a crucial part of the city, and earlier we used to have different functionality of industrial zones or other zones which have lost their meaning, but the city is developing and the situation is the following. Talking about the small Moscow railway ring, it is also to contribute to the development of polycentricity, because this project used to be the border of Moscow, but now it is inside Moscow, and now we have new points of growth there. We have new developers' projects, new points of growth, and the transport infrastructure allows us to carry a lot of passengers, and now we try to establish those opportunities for transport interchange hubs and the growth points which will enable us to form new centers. And talking about these centers, they can be different. They can be aimed at the big center like city and at small centers as well. So thank you very much. We have three experts left which deal with design and planning. And I would like to give the floor to Leonid Kievsky and ask him to comment the polycentricity from the point of view of a planner. And the topic of our today's discussion is driver, and it needs to be divided into two parts, into drivers which are acting already and drivers which have potential character. I would like to dwell upon the drivers which are acting already, and we need to pay attention to them. That's a 5-year experience of construction of arterial roads in Moscow and development of subway. These are drivers which action can be seen, and real estate units follow them. And this survey shows that today these units, real estate units, which follow these acting drivers, exceed the growth of the real estate units in the center. So that's the defined trend which needs to be analyzed, scrutinized, because the ratio of drivers' efficiency is a very important thing to take into account. Because we have the issues ranging from the issues of urbanization and ending up with concrete projects. So we need to accelerate the experience and to scrutinize it. Thank you. Thank you, Alexander Timohov, Committee for Architecture and Urban Development of Moscow. Please, your comments on polycentricity. No one has any doubts in positive aspects of polycentricity. And the policy which is conducted in the run of 5 years gives tangible results. And our documents of territorial planning support the promotion of these ideas, and we hope that strict adherence to such policy will allow us to reach these indicators, which are quite expected. Thank you, and I would like to give the floor to Mr. Husnulin for the final speech. I will have a very short conclusion. Thank you very much to all. Let us finish our session and continue our work.